Well, another fine morning. Welcome back to the shop. You know, we lost power the other night. About 6:20 p.m., right? We still had some decent sunlight out. And the sky was, sunset was approaching right here in Michigan. And it wasn't too bad. It was, you know, high 30s, 40s right now. So it wasn't too bad, right? A little bit of chill in the house. The furnace is running at night. But we lost power right around dinner time. I think we just finished dinner time. So it wasn't a big deal. It wasn't a big rush. And I was like, you know what? This is going to be great. So I went down and I got my emergency outage box. And there's candles in there. There's a lighter in there. Some flashlights. Some reading material. Some of my ham radio stuff. So basically, whenever the power goes out, we go down and grab the box, bring it up, and light a candle or whatever. And enjoy it. Because, you know, of course, the Wi-Fi is off, and which is good. I love that. From time to time, right? So it wasn't bad. It was actually kind of pleasant. So we had about a good 45 minutes of quiet. A friend of mine who works at the power company, right? He had texted me and said, hey, there's an issue over by your house in one of the in the county park. So we're working on it right now. I said, oh, no biggie, you know, no big problem. We're enjoying this quiet right now. Some of my neighbors, they got a hold of me and said, hey, you power out too? And said, yep, everybody's power out. So everybody's enjoying it. So a friend of mine, he was enjoying a nice bourbon next to the fireplace and inside the house. Mom next door, she was, made sure she was good. She had candles, she had flashlights, and everything was good, you know. So I knew everybody was settled for the moment. And I figured if it goes into nighttime and, you know, the temperature's going to drop as soon as the sun goes down, and we're going to go probably into the high 20s. So by morning time, by the following morning, it's going to be pretty cold, right? So, you know, I started texting back and forth with my buddy with the power company. He said, yeah, that problem is over there. We're working on it right now, and it probably will be within an hour. So I was like, okay, cool. Well, let me go down here right now. And, you know, since the family was good in the house with the candles and everything was good. I had the ham radio going. Everything was good and calm and enjoyable. So I decided to come down here in the shop and roll the generator out because it's been months since I've run it, right? So I've got stable seafoam. There's seafoam in the fuel tank, and the fuel tank's almost full. I always turn off the gas to the carburetor because that's how I like to run it. After I run it, I change the oil. You know, if I run it like 10 hours or whatever, I change the oil, and then I turn the gas off and let it run itself out and turn off the key, because I do have electric start on it. I put a battery on it, so now it's got electric start. But I'm just thinking of this little incident. It didn't last long. About a bunch of you guys out there, and myself included. Now, I haven't started this thing in months, like I said. It might have been even, let me see, it wasn't last summer. I didn't turn it on at all last summer, which failed to do. We should always be starting these machines and things that we don't start often, every few months, just to make sure, you know, run some gasoline in there, make sure it's all running, and making sure the tires are full, and, you know, just the oil's good. Just, you know, as seasons change, those things come up. Just like the batteries that we put in our fire smoke detectors and all these things, right? So I pulled it out. I usually run it just outside the door here in the shop. So I backfeed it all the way up to the house and the barn and the garage. Everything else gets backfed from the generator so we can run the well and the furnace and whatever else we have to run, right? So I rolled it out there, turned the gas on. And I just waited because I kind of had an idea that something inside the carburetor is not just right. And I was correct because I turned it on, came back over here, got a couple of things out. I was going to, you know, I think I got my gloves in the dark. I had my, it was just dark enough so I had my my headlamp on. So, you know, I'm walking around here grabbing some tools. And I walked back over to it and it's dripping gasoline. I had an idea it was going to do that. And it was dripping gas through this carburetor. Now, this is just a cheap... Oh, man. It's a cheap generator. It's like one of those Champion ones, Sportsman, that you would get at a Tractor Supply. It's not like my Good Job Site one. I've got a Good Job Site one that that I don't, you know, get to for here. I just use this one for it because I got it really cheap years ago, you guys. It was like, I don't know, I got the big one, the 7,000, and then it came with a little portable 2,000 one that's still in the box over there, right? And I'm telling you, it must have been 8-9 years ago, something like that, when I picked this thing up. And it was cheap. It was the last thing, I believe it was back when Home Depot or Tractor Supply was new in the area. And you know how they change their stuff on their floor, you know, as seasons change. So this one, I picked it up for like way less than half off. I mean, it might have been $200, $250 for the, and I knew what I was buying. It's cheap stuff, but it still runs. You just need a little bit of more maintenance on these things. It's all China-made crap. I've already changed the hoses on it because they leaked immediately, cracked and leaked. So I put good hoses on, American-made stuff. And I'm guessing the float in this thing went bad. So I took it off. Meanwhile, a buddy of mine, you know, my power friend, he said, hey, he texted me back as I was going through this process. I was, you know, as I discovered the dripping coming out, he texted me and said, hey, we're gonna be on in 6 minutes, you'll have power. I said, all right, cool. So I continued to take this off, bring it in the shop, just because I knew I was gonna work on it today, the next morning. But guess what the problem was, you guys, and it's very unexpected. So you can never underestimate power loss in your area and what happens. Well, we have a county park just down the road, and he sent me a picture, and I'll put the picture here somewhere, one of these spots. It was a goose. A goose had accidentally touched both lines, you know, the top lines on the telephone poles have power. One leg here and one leg on the other side. You'll be all right if you touch one, but if you touch both at the same time, you're done. You know, we're talking over 13,000 volts. Well, that's what happened to this goose. The goose accidentally somehow hit both sides or whatever, and it fried it, burned the goose up a bit on the bottom side, but you'll see it in the pictures there. It's kind of laying there. And it knocked out the power for like, I don't know, maybe reports I heard was like 300 of us that was in the area, okay? Another report I heard was 50, and then I heard 5. So I don't know, it was a lot of people because I could hear generators running off in the distance. And so that's that. So anyway, power came back on, we're all good. I put this in here, let it sit overnight, let it drain, do whatever. And here we are. So my thought is this. Now, I'll bring you in a little bit closer and I'll start explaining what I'm gonna do and what I'm gonna look for when it comes to a little leaky carburetor, okay? It is, it's got electronic deal that goes in there, and the electronic needle that flows inside here, right? And I took that off. So I can get to the bowl. Now the float is inside of here. This thing was loaded up with fuel as soon as I turned it on. So gas was just dumping into this. So there's a rubber seal right there, gasket. And this body here has all these through holes in there. You guys can probably see those through holes and they're clear. I think I'm gonna spray this out with some cleaner though. That tip is open, the hole is open there, but it's got a little bit of varnish nastiness. So I'm gonna spray this out, even though it looks okay. I'm gonna go ahead and spray it. Spray it down with the carb cleaner. All right, let's see what's next. Let's see what else is inside here. I know the float is in here, so I'm gonna turn the bowl over and look for any kind of nastiness. It's not too bad in there, you guys, look. It's not bad at all, right? I'll just spray that. Now I can smell the tarnish. So I'll spray that. So that's gonna go in there. That's going in there. Now here's the float. And the float operates the needle, the flow needle that is right inside here. I know it's going to be hard to see on camera, but that flow needle is up underneath here, and see this little bracket is moving that needle up and down and up and down. It comes in here, the gas, and then it's inside there. So it's moving freely and clearly. I don't know why. I can take it apart and show you guys. Oh, it is. You push this little pin right here out. I'm gonna take my glove off for this one because I don't want to lose this part. So take this little pin out right here and hold everything because there's a spring, that spring loaded right there. So lift this up and, well, the needle just came out and it's down inside here. Let me grab it. There's the needle. And there's the seat where it goes inside there. I've had this apart so many times, you guys, because of this issue, and I don't know why it keeps happening. Maybe because it's cheap stuff, but it's sliding okay. It looks all right. And see, it's very simple. It's just the needle that opens and closes. It opens and closes. And it's held on. See how it's got this little hook thing behind there? And it just slides into this little float, just like the float in your toilet. Just kind of hooks in there, and as this moves up and down, well, then it takes the needle and makes sure it makes it, you know, open and close. And lets the gas in through here. So it sits like this, the gas comes in, drops down in here, and this float sits there and makes it turn on and off as it needs it. Just like a toilet bowl, okay? So to me, everything in there looks good. It looks clean. Blow through it. I'm gonna spray down inside here too. So this all looks good, you guys. I'm just gonna spray it all down. It's relatively clean, right? Choke. Here's a choke working back and forth. See? So I'm just gonna put it all in here and just give it a cleaning. That's all. Make sure the surfaces are nice. Like, this is a nice surface, so it's not bad. So I don't know why it was dripping. Maybe just the valve was, from sitting so long dry, it was just, the float was not moving up and down. Possibly that was it. So we'll just clean it up. That's all. That's what I'm saying. Because this stuff happens when you don't use stuff for a while and it just sits. So now that I've knocked everything loose, let's hit it with some carb cleaner. And we'll just put it back together and see if it leaks. And if it does, then it's something else. But simple stuff first. That's my motto. Let's just keep it simple first. And then we'll, if we have to escalate, we'll escalate. It still looks clean. Everything looks clean to me. I just want to make sure everything is running, moving, operating effectively. That way, like, see, everything moves. I don't want that to be any part of anything, so that's good there. Even though this looks clean, you guys, hold on, it's clean, but it's what do I say, like, all the holes in it are good, they're open, it just has some tarnish buildup on it that I just want to remove a little bit. But again, these holes, they're all clean, they're all through. Looks like it's all lubed up properly. I don't see any debris where it could be leaking. There's a little bit of buildup on here, you know. Little bit of buildup, and maybe that's where it was. Well, no, it couldn't have been, because see, the leak, it just didn't stop. Who knows? Maybe it could have been this. What I'm saying, this is this little seal again, that gasket right there. Maybe it was just that gasket that was leaking. Don't know. I'm gonna check it and see if it's hardened up. It's got some bounce to it. All the holes are good. That's good. I can see through all these holes. Right inside here is where the electronic needle flow control sets inside there. So let's make sure that stays nice and clean inside there. It looks good to me. Now, here is the needle itself. I'm just going to spray it. It's already clean, but I'm going to hit it again. It's got a little bit of scale on there. All right. That's it. I'm going to put it together now. There is... You guys, there's some friction. A little bit of friction in here where this needle goes. See that? It's a little bit of friction. I can feel it. It's not smooth. It's like stuttery, like jittery-like. So I guess I should still put it together. Let me see here. And... see if I can ride it out. It just feels like, when I say smooth, it's like kind of like chalky or something. You know what I mean? Like stuttery. All right, let's do this again. Get that down in there. Line up this hole. And then put this pin back in there. Okay. There it is. So we're back in business. Now it's sliding up pretty good. See? So the way it works is it's down like this. And then when the gasoline fills that bowl, this bowl right here, it lifts up here and shuts off and turns on. So when it's full of fuel, goes up and turns it off and stops the flow of gas coming in. I mean, look, it's... You know, this... For this piece of equipment that is cheap like this, you guys... I've got a ton of other ones, you know, small engines on some of the smaller equipment too. And some engines that you don't have to do this stuff to. But this right here is just a common, cheap little maintenance issue, I would say. Maintenance, okay? Because I'm not buying anything for it. I'm just got to clean it up a bit and keep it a little bit maintenance, okay? So... It runs when you need it to, because if I had to depend on this last night, I'd be out here last night doing this. And it's much more pleasant to do it right now when I'm not under pressure. I'm checking all the seals. All these seals look good. The surface right here looks all right. I'm going to hit it with this first. So some of this stuff is maintenance and some of it just gets old. Like some of these gaskets, like this big gasket right here where the bowl sits to, that mating surface. I mean, some of these just go bad, right? So sometimes you just have to have some parts on hand, because you never know. If I get a gas leak like that and it's not running right and you don't want gas going all over the place. So again, like if I had to depend on this last night, I would have been out here last night in the dark doing this. So this is like the last thing you want to do when the power goes out, is have to do all this stuff. So check it when it's nice out. Just take a little time, and when it's much more convenient and easy for you to do. All right, so that's that. I'm going to seat this all the way down. Okay, right here, remember I told you right here, that's where this goes, and that's that electronic, I don't know what is that, I don't know, it's an electronic control for electronic ignition control, electronic flow, I don't know, you guys tell me in the comments below. But I just know that goes there, and I got it lined up. I tell you what, when I'm talking about this cheap Chinese stuff, these screws, you guys, are horrible. They just the heads of them strip right out. Look at that. You see that? The heads of these things strip right on out with the it's a very light amount of torque. So I, like I said earlier, I changed the oil in this. I usually change the oil after every storm, and if I run this thing, I don't know, 5 to 10 hours, I'm changing that oil, no matter what, because oil is cheap enough, even though it's expensive nowadays, it's still cheap enough to throw a quart or so in of oil than it is to rebuild a motor like this or buy a new machine. And nobody has time for that, especially me. I don't want to be doing that. So only gonna have to buy a new motor when it's absolutely necessary. We might have some visitors here in a minute, you guys. Oh, I hope it's not one of the roosters, because it'll be so loud on camera. So this is that USA made hose that I put on, because the other one just cracked, the one that came with it, one of those clear plastic Chinese ones. Let's test this. I'm just gonna push it back tight and see what happens. Let's see if we get any gas leak. All right, it's running. I believe it's filling up. I'm gonna mess with this throttle. Okay, I'm not seeing any drips or anything, you guys. Let's turn it back off and hook up the rest of the carb, and we'll check the oil, and then we will check the gasoline and give it a test run. All right, the battery's been charging all night. Get out, ladies. Let's go. That's right. Hey, you too. You got to get going. Come on. My goodness. Let's go turn the key, see what happens. She's choked. Let's bump the key a little bit. All right. Now this one. Alright, and then this little feller, that keeps this from going crazy. It's already sprayed, it's clean, see, I sprayed it. So that's just gonna stay and go back on like that. Everything's nice and tight. So you guys, this is a 13 horsepower Sportsman series. I think it's a knockoff of, I don't know, either a Kohler, Kawasaki, maybe a Honda, I'm not sure. But let's get it out into the light and let's take a look all around, right? It's a 7,000 watt Sportsman series by Buffalo Tools. It is, again, this thing's a cheap China model, knockoff, right? It did come with a starter, so I put a battery on it, had to make this little holder for the battery. What you want to do is, if you have a battery on yours, make sure that you put a little tender on it every few months, keep it topped off. You know, I failed on the maintenance on this. Luckily, power came back quickly, but now we're back in business with this. The battery's topped off, oil is good, the carburetor is fixed now, so it's not just running water or running fuel out, dumping fuel. So, like I said, it was just stuck, that float was just stuck on something. So, if the battery does not work, obviously we have a pull start. Okay, so the next thing I'm going to do is open this up. I'll check the gasoline. It does smell bad, like turpentine, varnishy, right? I'm going to let this thing run for a little while, and I'm going to probably put some sea foam or some Marvel mystery oil in there, and just let it run for a while. I'm going to let the engine get nice and hot. I'll probably spray it and clean it, but you know, for most of its life, it just sits in storage here in the barn until these power outages. But when you do that to these little machines, little engines, things go bad, like these hoses, right? These little hoses just they can't last, so you have to make sure you change the hoses, you know, the gas lines, and you know they're on the other side here. So it's a little silly stuff that happens with these usually. It's not, you know, if it's something major, it's either the generator part or the engine part fails. So far on this one, it's all good. I've definitely got my money's worth. If you guys have a generator, gas generator, diesel, whatever it is, you know, if it's a mechanical one like this, think about doing maintenance on this stuff more regularly. You guys might do it way more regular than I did here on this one, but I'm ready for the next storm. I'm gonna make sure this, you know, as we approach spring and get into summer, I know these things tend to not get used much unless you, you know, taking them out and use them for a specific thing. But maintenance wise, go ahead and do your maintenance on these things and make sure, because you don't want to be like in the situation I was last night where it was just getting dark. If the power didn't come on, I would have been out here at nighttime messing with this stuff, which, you know, hey, I've done it before, but I'm sick of it. So take advantage of these nice days. It doesn't take long. It only took me about, well, with filming, if I wasn't filming this, it would probably take me 15, 20 minutes, and that was it. I did add new hard tires to this, you guys, because it came with these little rubber tires with inner tubes, and they just kept going flat, all the time flat. So I bought these hard ones, and you know what's funny? This one's staying nice around, but the other side is getting a flat spot in it. I don't get it. You can't put air in these things, and they just, is anything made good? I guess if I spent more money and got like a quality machine, probably so. But even these replacement tires, hey, more China garbage. What I'd like to see you do is make sure your family's on the ready. I don't want to be stuck in the dark, out in the cold, in a situation where you have to do this stuff when it's not very conducive to being out here. Like today, nice sunshine, it's a decent day out here. I'm not in a rush, and it's all done and it's ready for the next one. So thanks for hanging out with me again today here at the, today at the shop, and we'll see you on the next one, because I have a lot more things coming up. So we'll talk to you guys soon. All right, stay dangerous, you guys. Stay dangerous.